As far back as mankind can remember, there's been a desire to fly. But it wasn't until the 20th century that technology had advanced enough to finally allow this dream to come true. In Canada, a group of young men, led by the aging Alexander Graham Bell, were forming a group called the Aerial Experiment Association. History was made on February 23, 1909, when John McCurdy of the AEA flew the Silver Dart for a half a mile over the frozen waters of Lake Bradour in Nova Scotia. This was the first flight of a heavier-than-air machine in Canada, 6 years after the Wright brothers' flight at Kitty Hawk in the United States. About this time, another young man was getting up early in the morning to test aircraft engines from the roof of his hardware store. Although William Gibson endeavored to work in secrecy, news did leak out, and he was greeted on the streets of Victoria, BC by passers-by, flapping their arms when they saw him. Gibson persevered, completing the first successful aircraft engine in Canada, and on September 24th, 1910, flew his Gibson twin plane 200 feet before crashing it into a stand of oak trees. Thunder Bay saw its first aircraft in 1910. Edward C. Peterson put together a Blériot-type monoplane in the back of his sign shop on Victoria Avenue. He and Peter Scott managed to construct most of the plane themselves, with exception of the engine, which arrived from Toronto. With its completion, an eager crowd gathered at Kelly's Racetrack in Fort William for the trial flight. His $1,000 venture wasn't successful on the first, second, or next few attempts. But Peterson's efforts finally paid off by 1911 when he flew his aircraft 1/4 of a mile, taking off Mission Island. This photograph has recorded what may indeed be that very flight, but no one really knows for sure. With the declaration of war in 1914, the airplane soon became a machine of destruction. Men from across the country volunteered to fight overseas with the Imperial Armed Forces. Some were to become heroes. One in particular was Stanley Rosevere from Port Arthur, who served in the Royal Naval Air Service and was accredited with 23 aerial victories. He never lived to receive his bar to the Distinguished Service Cross. Stanley was killed in 1918 during a battle practice. Following the war, some of the returning pilots and planes were put to work in the newly formed Ontario Provincial Air Service. The HS-2L flying boat was a plane used in the war to detect enemy positions. It was a machine that was affectionately cursed by those who flew it due to its average top speed of 60 miles per hour and its habit of breaking down so often that a mechanic was taken on most flights. Its value in forest fire detection, search and rescue, and transportation of men and equipment in the remote areas of the North became quickly evident. This was still a time of daring exploits by young men in flying machines, and Al Cheeseman, a former Port Arthur alderman, had his share. Downed so many times, he was thought to be indestructible. Cheeseman was a pilot on world-famous flights to the North and South Poles. By 1929, a small group of Air Force veterans had petitioned the government for a landing field charter. Their success resulted in the opening of Bishop's Field off Roslyn Road. Hector Dougal, who was the first pilot to fly north of the 53rd latitude, became president of the Fort William Aero Club. Rides were offered to the public for $5 each in either of the club's two gypsy moths, the ladybug and firefly. All kinds of people took part in the Aero Club's flying lessons. But flying was still a perilous occupation, for anything could go wrong. Only a year later, an Aero Club instructor, James Dickey, was demonstrating to a pupil in a side slip landing. The engine stalled, spinning the aircraft into a fatal crash. During the summer of 1931, Fort William and Port Arthur received a visit from the Trans-Canada Air Pageant. This was a time of showing off the variety of planes in existence at the time and what they could be expected to do. Spectators were treated to the sight of dives and loops and inverted flying and parachuting. The hit of the show was the autogyro, the predecessor to the helicopter. In 1938, construction was begun on the Fort William Municipal Airport. This event was the culmination of years of bickering between the two cities as to where the airport would be located. A site at Intercity, which would be suitable for a combination land and seaplane base, was strongly favored by both cities. However, the advice of a federal government official was finally accepted and the present site chosen. The seaplane base was situated at the north end of Port Arthur, just beyond the Port Arthur Shipbuilding Company. The Canadian Car and Foundry Company began manufacturing a wide variety of planes just prior to World War II. In fact, it was to gain the reputation for record production of pounds of aircraft per man. The Maple Leaf Trainer was designed by Elsie McGill, who had become the chief aeronautical engineer for Canadian Car and Foundry in Fort William. This biplane was intended to be a prototype used for a training aircraft in Mexico. Work was underway on the Gregor FDB-1, a one-seater biplane fighter. It was the first all-Canadian aeroplane built for military air operations, but was soon to be outphased by the monoplane. Meanwhile, the company was busy producing Grumman Goblins, a two-seat fighter plane. A total of 57 were built, of which some were sold to the Royal Canadian Air Force and some to Turkey. Canadian Car didn't really get into full production until 1942, when 15 Hawker Hurricanes a week were being produced for Great Britain. Here, workers are holding down the tail section during an engine test. This fabric-covered aircraft was fitted with a Rolls-Royce engine, which had a maximum speed of 350 miles per hour. Over 1,000 planes were produced for Britain's defense during World War II. At one annual employees' picnic, three Hawker Hurricanes were donated to the Wings for Britain Fund. The planes were built on the employees' own time, money, and initiative. After the hurricanes, the plant began changing over to the construction of Curtiss Wright Helldivers for the U.S. Navy. This was a complex process because the British metric system had to be replaced with American blueprinting. By 1944, employment in the factory had risen from 114 to 6,800, of which half were women. In every branch of production, they would be found working, from heavy labor in the machine shops to the foundry to the final assembly line. The Helldiver was considered the newest and most powerful dive bomber of its type. They were equipped with four-bladed propellers, and the folding wings enabled them to be used on aircraft carriers. Nicknamed the Beast, they were the first cannon-firing Navy aircraft and could carry a heavy bomb load. After the planes were tested, they would be referred to as flyaways and departed in formations of threes. However, during 1944, on occasion, no fewer than 14 flyaways were seen leaving the Fort William Airport. By V-Day, Canadian Car had built 836 Curtiss torpedo bombers. September of 1946 marked the inauguration of daily plane service between Fort William Port Arthur and Duluth Superior by Trans-Canada Airlines, and hence of regular airmail delivery for these cities. In less than 50 years, Edward Peterson's wildest dreams of air flight between northern communities had been realized and more. A regular air service now linked Fort William and Port Arthur with major cities of Canada and the world.